friends, I'm honored to welcome you to this historic gathering. The talents and good work of a lot of people went into this event, and I'm going to take a moment here at the outset to give proper recognition to a few of them. I'd like to start off by first noting that the idea for a festive volume in Richard's honor was Jerry Bradford's, my predecessor at the Neal A. Maxwell Institute. Jerry not only hatched the idea for a festschrift, but he steadfastly supported my increasingly grandiose plans for an accompanying colloquium. So, Jerry, thank you very much. You should know, too, that when I first approached Richard himself with the idea for a volume and a colloquium, he declined politely, but he was sure that he'd been honored enough already. But he called back the next day and agreed to let us proceed if, and only if, the colloquium and volume did not focus on his scholarly contributions. Instead, Richard himself insisted that this event explore Mormonism in the Academy, or even Mormons in the Academy. It's that intersection between the worlds of faith and intellectual life that has so occupied his late career, after all. I know Richard just well enough to know that he'd disapprove of a lengthy tribute at this point, so I'll just say this. This colloquium reflects my own scholarly and religious debts to his prodigious influence, and I know many in this room agree and feel as I do. So while this event intends to explore ideas and to express gratitude, I'll note that it also reflects his own priorities. Not only did he recommend the theme, but this colloquium gathers diverse scholars and commentators together, Latter-day Saints and non-Latter-day Saints alike. And you'll likely observe over the next 2 days that these conversations will be at once rigorous and candid and generous. In other words, much of what happens here bears the imprint of Richard Lyman Bushman himself, his own remarkable life and career. I insisted, as things developed, that there was no better place to explore the intersection of faith and intellect than here at BYU and under the auspices of the Neal A. Maxwell Institute. The institutions that support the Institute and the name we bear demand that the Institute, of all places, attend to the Mormon in Mormon studies with care and with courage, but we must reckon with that question. So thanks to everyone who has expended time or talent or resources to support the Maxwell Institute's mission. A couple of other notes here about individuals. Kathleen Flake, the Richard Lyman Bushman Professor in Mormon Studies at the University of Virginia, and Jed Woodworth at the LDS Church History Library have graciously functioned as co-organizers of this event with me. So I'd like to publicly acknowledge my gratitude for each of them helping to shoulder the load of this historic gathering. I'm also glad to report that we found eager institutional partners for such an undertaking. I'll turn your attention to the back of your printed program at this point. As you scan that auspicious list, you might agree with me that this is perhaps an unprecedented event in terms of both the breadth and the diversity of its partnerships in the broad Mormon studies world. A warm thank you to all of our institutional sponsors listed there. We included as well a program insert, little card that you'll see if you're like me. It's fallen out of your program a couple of times. But it's there, and it's there to highlight three families in particular who deserve special expressions of gratitude. Significant financial support for this event was provided by H. Brent and Bonnie Jean Beasley, David A. and Linda C. Nieren, and Tom and Cheryl Quinn. These generous Latter-day Saints are not scholars, but they share our core conviction at the Maxwell Institute, namely that Mormonism's relationship to the life of the mind isn't best characterized by however, but by therefore. For their vision and their generosity, we are especially appreciative. Special thanks, too, to the committed staff of the Maxwell Institute. I here single out Jeremy King, Camille Messick, Melissa Hartley, Alicia Hill, Claudia Racinos, and Blair Hodges for a lot of work. Their name badges are in blue. You can pick them out. Their name badges are in blue, their smiles are genuine, and they're anxious to help in any way they can. Ask them for help if you need any. We want to be great hosts for the next couple of days. They've been very helpful to me personally, and I owe them each a personal debt of gratitude as well. To our speakers and commentators for this session and all that follow, I extend a warm welcome, a deep expression of gratitude as well. Some of you have come long distances. Some of you are brand new to Mormon studies. Some are visiting BYU for the first time. But they are all united by their appreciation of Richard, and they were eager to come and join us to honor him. Participants, if you've not yet picked up your participants packet, it's located at a table near the entrance just outside this room. Make sure you grab one before lunch today. At my insistence, the next 2 days' worth of presentations are limited to a mere 15 minutes each. We are going to keep this show moving. To participants, I'm sorry. I realize you're set at 20 minutes at academics. To the audience, you're welcome. This is an experiment of sorts. You can blame me, but I'm suffering not only from a growing sense of academic conference fatigue with all my veteran years of experience under my belt, but our collective sense as organizers was that this is a working scholarly colloquium. That is, presenters are trying out their preliminary perspectives here for the first time in draft form. So we knew that each would benefit from expert scholarly responses and from generous Q&A sessions. So, you who are visiting as members of the audience, in the Q&A sessions, feel free to nudge authors toward directions you'd like to see them go, towards ideas you'd like to see them develop. After this event, they will be crafting revised and expanded versions of their presentations for today and tomorrow for publication in a Festschrift volume. Look for that in 2017. So help us, 2017. It will appear. So, end of my introduction. Without further ado, we'll now turn to the voices and the ideas that bring us together for this colloquium. So I now welcome you to our first session. Here we are. Here they are. I'm going to introduce them briefly. For their full academic bios, will you look at the center section of your program? I'm already sick of my own voice. Not hardly, says Kathleen Flake from somewhere in the audience. I'll announce them all together, and then I'll sit down. They'll come up in the order that I read them off. We'll first hear from Matt Groh. He is Director of Publications at the LDS Church History Department. His title is The Role of the Church History Department in Mormon Scholarship, a Reflection on the Leonard J. Arrington Era and the Present. Matt Bowman will follow from Henderson State University in Arkansas. His title, The Second Vatican Council and Mormon Correlation from Pulpit and Pew. Jana Riess will follow. Matt, from Religion News Service, her title, Richard Bushman and the Future of Mormon Teaching, and Bob Goldberg, director of the Tanner Humanities Center at the University of Utah, will provide comment. So will you join me in welcoming our presenters with a round of applause, and we'll call Matt to the podium.
Well, when I realized that Spencer had invited most of the people to arrive just as I was ending my presentation, I didn't know whether to be relieved or offended. But looking at this very distinguished audience, I now realized that relief was not the right reaction. this is a real privilege for me to be here, and I've thought about what I can contribute to a discussion of Mormonism in the academy. As someone currently with one foot in the academy and one foot squarely outside, I wanted to begin autobiographically. Shortly after I began my graduate studies at Notre Dame, I received an offer to work for the Joseph Smith Papers, then a part of BYU and now a part of the LDS Church History Department. The previous year, I had attended Richard Bushman's summer seminar program on Joseph Smith and the culture of 19th century America. At that time, I envisioned two paths to influencing the understanding of Latter-day Saint history in the academy, each represented by one of the giants in the field of Mormon history over the past several decades, Richard Bushman and Leonard Arrington. The Bushman path meant writing outside of Mormon history so that you could later use that understanding to deepen your insights into the Latter-day Saint path. It also meant working from a university, probably outside of Utah. The Arrington path, by contrast, emphasized working primarily on Mormon history and doing so from within the institutional church. Of course, the paths were never as distinct as I envisioned. Bushman, the outsider, was a savvy insider, while Arrington was the insider who often felt on the outside. As a distinguished scholar and faithful Latter-day Saint, Bushman has influenced Mormon history and insider circle for decades, including writing one of the volumes for Arrington's 16-volume sesquicentennial series and helping launch the Joseph Smith Papers. Arrington, who from one perspective was the ultimate insider as the official church historian, imagined the church history department operating much like a semi-autonomous academic department, and was thus surprised to find that ecclesiastical superiors questioned some of his publications. As I thought about taking time off from graduate studies to join the Joseph Smith Papers, I decided that I wanted to pursue the Bushman path, not the Arrington one. I would write about the Latter-day Saint tradition not from within the church, but from within the academy. I stayed at Notre Dame, completed my graduate studies, and landed a job at the University of Southern Indiana. And then 6 years ago this month, the Arrington path interceded. Reed Nielsen, with whom I'd become friends during Bushman's summer seminar program, was now the managing director of the church history department. Reed asked if I would be interested in a job with the department. He is always recruiting. I told him no. But Reed painted a compelling picture of the present dynamics and future possibilities of that department. He was admirably patient with me as I wrestled spiritually and intellectually with the decision. What would it mean to abandon the Bushman path for the Arrington one? And what if I ended up not liking the Arrington path or being particularly good at it? The position, after all, would require me to manage roughly 40 full-time employees, which was 39 and a half more than I was managing at the University of Southern Indiana Center for Communal Studies. I worried that one could transition from the Bushman path to the Arrington path, but probably not back very easily. After several months, accepting the job at the church history department felt spiritually right, and I took the position. Rick Turley, the assistant church historian, told me that not only had I taken the Arrington path, but now that I occupied Arrington's position. I didn't have his title or his sterling credentials, but I had his place in the organizational chart. Arrington, as director of the publications division, Arrington had never managed the historical department, rather he'd managed the history division, a team of researchers charged with publishing Mormon history. Our current day publications division is heir to that history division. So I want to talk for a few minutes about what is the role of the Arrington path, and more specifically of church-sponsored publications in the study of Mormon history. The church history department plays an unusual role. I know of no counterpart of similar size and scope in Methodist history or American Catholic history or American Jewish history. I want to reflect on the Arrington era, the so-called Camelot period, with its reputation of wide-open archives and cutting-edge contributions by using Gregory Prince's new biography, Leonard Arrington, in the Writing of Mormon History. Arrington is the hero of Prince's book as he battles members of the church hierarchy in defense of an honest telling of Mormon history. But Prince acknowledges that Arrington is a flawed hero. Had he been more attuned to the realities of working for the church, had he fought his battles with less naivete, he might have been able to effect more consequential change, Prince says. As I've read the biography, I've been struck by how much we are still working on Arrington's agenda. This year, the Church History Department will publish the minutes of the Council of 50 in Nauvoo and a documentary history of the Relief Society. Arrington anticipated both of these books. When he accepted the position of church historian, he brought up the issue of the Council of 50 to Elder Howard W. Hunter of the Quorum of the Twelve. "Why not disclose them?" Hunter asked. "They are a part of our history." The history of the Relief Society also has its roots in the 1970s when members of Arrington's team sought to publish the minutes of the Relief Society in Nauvoo. A documentary impulse animated Arrington, and it remains crucial to our own agenda. Whereas Arrington envisioned a multi-volume documentary series on Brigham Young, a reflection of his interest in the American West, our defining project has considered the church's founding decades through the Joseph Smith Papers, which will include over 24 books and a website. Given the centrality of the Joseph Smith era for Latter-day Saint history and identity, the Joseph Smith Papers, I think, has exerted a more profound influence on Mormon history than the Young Papers could have. And Arrington's hope for a larger series of documentary histories was scuttled as a result of controversies surrounding the first volume published. Arrington also believed in narrative history, as evidenced by the aborted 16-volume sesquicentennial history, The Story of the Latter-day Saints, written by his two assistant church historians, and his own co-authored The Mormon Experience. While we have focused more on documentary than narrative histories, we're currently transitioning to a stronger focus on narrative. Arrington also strongly advocated for women's history and for history from the ground up, impulses that we share with him. We also share Arrington's vision of how an honest and scholarly history can contribute to the good of the church and the good of the academy. Arrington wrote in his journal in August 1972, "On the one hand, I am the church historian and must seek to build testimony, spread the word, build the kingdom. On the other hand, I am called to be an historian, which means that I must earn the respect of professional historians. What I write must be craftsmanlike, credible, and of good quality. This means that I stand on two legs, the leg of faith and the leg of reason. Balancing the two, he admitted, is our toughest problem." As he phrased it on another occasion, "We are trained to publish for our professional colleagues, being honest, straightforward, fearless, analytical, raising questions." But he also recognized that church authorities and church and the church audience want and have a right to expect faith-promoting history. While we share many of Arrington's impulses, there are deep differences between Arrington's era and our own because of changes internal and external to the church, including an acceptance of transparency, structural changes at the church, and the internationalization of church membership. Shifts within Mormon culture mean that we experience a very different climate than did Arrington and his fellow historians. In the 1970s, there existed deep divisions within the church's leadership and membership and between different segments of church employees over the value of transparency on historical topics. Arrington bore the scars of these battles. Prince argues that these clashes, particularly the opposition of some senior apostles to Arrington's approach, were the primary reason that Arrington's team was transferred to BYU in the early 1980s. By contrast, we are the beneficiaries of a broad consensus among church leaders and members that transparency is essential, that ultimately it will build faith rather than destroy it. Vigorous discussions still occur over how we explain certain controversies and where exactly the boundaries are. But there is a consensus that introducing church members, especially young people, to controversial topics within church settings is preferable than them learning about controversial topics in other ways. Arrington believed we need to inoculate people by giving them exposure to facets of the history of the church that might be uncomfortable. God does not need our lies, he taught. Elder Marlon K. Jensen, the former church historian, likewise believed that we need to inoculate people within the household of faith, and that the Spirit cannot witness to a false testimony. The Gospel Topics essays on controversial historical topics that were produced by the Church History Department with oversight and approval by senior church leaders are evidence of this new climate. Prince documents the acrimonious disputes between some historians and members of the church educational system in the 1970s. By contrast, we're working with the Seminary Institute writers to integrate the Gospel Topics essays into the curriculum. Structural changes within church administration and within the church history department have also created a different climate. Arrington was the only church historian who was a professional historian and not an ecclesiastical leader in the history of the church. Since the revival of the position of church historian in 2005, the church historian has been a senior member of the First Quorum of the 70, Elder Jensen and now Elder Stephen Snow. Prince suggests that Arrington was unable to navigate the complex dynamics of church headquarters, including opposition from some members of the 12. A church historian who is a general authority has helped create a different atmosphere, an atmosphere more of cooperation between the various segments of the church headquarters. Arrington worried intensely about ecclesiastical reviews of historical publications, either by church leaders or by the Correlation Department, which is charged with reviewing church publications for doctrinal accuracy. In my experience, church leaders now have greater trust in publications written at the Church History Department, and historians have a deeper appreciation for working with church leaders and the Correlation Department. This greater acceptance of historians reflects both the consensus that difficult topics need to be addressed and a change at church headquarters as the church has come to value professionals in areas from history to website design to public affairs. Indeed, I don't recognize many of Arrington's struggle in my own experience there. Arrington lamented, "One cannot raise questions with ecclesiastical superiors." I was told very explicitly when I began there, if you don't bring your best thinking and raise the toughest questions, you're of no use to us. The internationalization of church membership has also changed how we write history, particularly when we were writing for church members. Arrington had a deep interest in international history, but when he became church historian, the dramatic growth in Latin America and in Africa was still just beginning or in the future. The average church member in 1970 looks very different than the average church member does today in terms of geography, demography, level of education. Today, the Church History Department has local volunteer historians around the world who gather material, conduct oral interviews, and write histories for websites and church magazines. Some of these are non-professional historians, but then every once in a while you can convince a Richard and Claudia Bushman to sign up as well. A final difference is in the size, composition, and structure of the publications division. With the exception of Davis Benton and James Allen, who had joint appointments in the history division in their universities, Arrington primarily hired historians who were beginning graduate programs or whose graduate training was in the future. We've been fortunate that when we hire, there's always a deep pool of historians with PhDs applying. Their graduate training and wide-ranging dissertations mean that they've embraced a key element of what I once saw as the Bushman path, writing on areas outside of Mormonism to develop that deep understanding before joining the Arrington path. Our operation is also much larger than Arrington's. One reason for that is because we publish our own material through our own press, and we have a team of editors and others who help us. So what is the role of the Church History Department in future Mormon scholarship? In the Doctrine and Covenants, the church historian is charged with writing for the good of the church and for the rising generations. We see in this a scriptural mandate that history should be written at the institutional level, and that accurate and authoritative publications from the Church History Department should play a role in both academic scholarship and in public understanding of Mormon history among both church members and others. As we've considered the future, we have asked, what can we do from the Church History Department that maybe can't be done elsewhere? As we've considered possibilities, we've focused on objectives like these: to highlight the department's significant archival collections, like we do with the Joseph Smith Papers; to provide an authoritative voice on church history, including on controversial topics; to exercise leadership by focusing our resources on topics that have been relatively neglected, such as women's history and the history of the international church. After I decided to take the Arrington path rather than the Bushman path, I read Arrington's autobiography, Adventures of a Church Historian. My time at church headquarters has sometimes felt like an adventure, but not quite as tumultuous as Arrington's was. I found it to be an intense period of professional development and in an exciting and productive time. We are the beneficiaries of Arrington's vision, and the work of many others, including Richard Bushman, who have contributed to the cultural change in which an honest and faithful appraisal of Mormon history is embraced rather than discouraged. Like Arrington, I believe that myself and other historians at the Church History Department have responsibilities both to build testimony, spread the word, build the kingdom, and to produce history that is academically responsible and that earns the respect of professional historians. If we strike the right balance, the Arrington path will continue to play a vibrant role in the writing of Mormon history during an era that Richard Bushman has described as the golden age of Mormon history. Thanks.
As Matt did, I want to say first, it was an honor to be invited to participate in this colloquium. And I reflected, as I started thinking about what I wanted to speak on many of the same ideas that Matt Groh brought up. That is, the title of this symposium is Mormonism in the Academy. And as Matt said a moment ago, as Leonard Arrington reflected on the title of church historian, this raises a possible tension. What does it mean to write scholarship as a Mormon, as a Latter-day Saint, and at the same time write scholarship about the Latter-day Saints? This is, of course, not simply an issue that LDS scholars think about. Evangelical scholars who write scholarship about evangelical history, or Catholic scholars who write scholarship about Roman Catholicism, face a similar conundrum. What is history, right? What does it mean to write history? And that is the topic I want to grapple with a bit today by comparing one instance of the ways in which Roman Catholics have wrestled with the problem through the Second Vatican Council, but that Mormons did as well in Mormon correlation, which occurred at about the same time. So I want then to talk about change and how scholars think about change versus how religious people think about change and what these tensions might mean and how we might think about how to deal with them. Particularly, I want to talk about change in the 1960s. And if there's anything that scholars of the 60s can agree on, it is that decade was very much about change, and not necessarily even incrementalist, piecemeal, Hillary Clinton-style change, but dramatic, sweeping Bernie Sanders-style change. In 1963, Students for a Democratic Society issued a statement called America in the New Era that warned that America was mired in a politics of adjustment, that America was dominated by something called the establishment. A, quote, mediating, rationalizing, managerial elite that views its problems as technical and administrative rather than ideological or moral. But at the same time, SDS believed that the Enlightenment offered liberation as well as captivity. SDS promised that thanks to advances in agriculture and mechanics, the working poor would soon have the freedom and the leisure to participate in politics. Thanks to advances in communications, SDS said, international diplomacy would soon grow much more intimate and the Cold War would come to an end. The document that is spoke about historical change in secular language, which is to say that it credited change to forces outside those they deemed to be religious, to human ingenuity, to the power of reason and choice, the spread of democracy. But at the same time, other Americans had a much more fraught relationship with secular ideas about history. Mormons and American Catholics were members of traditions which sought to resist secular narratives about change in their churches. There is no such thing as an accurate, objective history of the church without consideration of the spiritual powers that attend this work, claimed the Mormon apostle Boyd K. Packer. Far earlier, at the Fifth Lateran Council in 1512, a Catholic cardinal offered a similar axiom that was repeated well into the 20th century. Man must be changed by religion and not religion by man. Both traditions then have faced challenges engaging with those aspects of secular history that I've used the New Left as a shorthand for. confidence that historical change derives from human effort. Put another way, they have struggled with what Grant Wacker has called historical consciousness, that is, acknowledgement that ideas, particularly religious ideas, are conditioned and shaped by the age in which they occur. In the 19th century, Protestants and Roman Catholics grappled with these ideas, and it caused some pain in both traditions. The excommunication of Catholic modernist thinkers at the turn of the 20th century, the fundamentalist controversy in American Protestantism in the 1920s. In recent decades, Mormons have also felt that trauma. There are, I suspect, few Latter-day Saint historians who have not paused for a moment above their keyboard, grappling, perhaps not with historical consciousness itself, for hardly anyone would deny the power of that idea as an explanatory mechanism, but with a thought for how the work of their keyboard might be received by those in their tradition who are convinced that history doesn't work that way. One aspect of living in a modern secular America is that it is now impossible for them not to wrestle with that dilemma. Now, it has been traditional for a long time for scholars of Mormonism to juxtapose it with the evangelical Protestantism of the Second Great Awakening, the period in which Mormonism emerged for reasons of chronology, if nothing else. But doing so places Mormonism within a certain historiographical narrative about American Christianity. In the two or three generations after independence, American Christians absorbed the sensibilities of revolutionary and Jacksonian America and hence embraced a democratic ethos. They discarded Calvinist gloominess in favor of an enthusiastic optimism about humanity. They rejected theological debates in favor of a relentless ethicism. They overturned trained ministry in favor of lay preaching. Placing Mormonism in that narrative conditions us to emphasize certain things about it, and hence perhaps to overlook others. Indeed, the further into the 20th century we get, the less useful the Protestant model appears. Certainly, even by the time the Mormons arrived in the Utah Valley, their population was far more diverse than any argument crediting its appeal solely to its appeal to Jacksonian Americans might admit. By 1960, the time the correlation begins, 10% of the church population was outside the United States. Similarly, Mormons from Joseph Smith's time on constructed a church hierarchy far more powerful than any that the Protestant ministers the Smith family might have known could imagine. By the 20th century, indeed, this apparatus was so unwieldy that several church presidents in a row sought to wrestle it into some form of order and finally succeeded only in the 1960s. It is in that era, then, that Mormon scholars and leaders alike encountered the dilemma of historical consciousness in earnest. So today I want to use correlation as a case study for thinking about how Mormons and Catholics together have thought about that intersection between historical consciousness and secular ways of thinking about history. John Butler has made the case that, in fact, this is a good thing, that we should think more about the models that Roman Catholics offer. I'm thinking about American religion, issues like heterogeneity, material culture, and institution. I'm putting aside for a moment, I hope, Protestant themes like conversion and soul liberty. And this point particularly resonates, I think, because American Catholics and Mormons have both found the issue of historical consciousness particularly sharp because they exist within an institutional religion that claims, in some sense, to be outside history. And both traditions, as I said, have encountered controversy over this point. Nearly 100 years after the excommunication of Catholic modernist thinkers, Mormon intellectuals faced similar dilemmas. So a juxtaposition, I think, of Mormon correlation with the American Catholic response to Vatican II will shed new light on the ways in which both traditions grappled with this problem. So in the 1960s, both the LDS Church and the Roman Catholic Church mounted major reform efforts. The Second Vatican Council, which met from 1962 to 65, altered the liturgy of the Catholic Church, emphasized collegiality and lay participation. It downplayed a monarchical interpretation of the Catholic hierarchy, and it took steps towards formulating a Catholic concept of religious freedom. The Mormon program, commonly called at the time priesthood correlation, and simply correlation today, was a bureaucratic revolution, inaugurated in 1961 and concluded roughly a decade later. While Vatican II then emphasized decentralization, in part because the Catholic Church was gigantic and cosmopolitan, correlation implemented in a much smaller church emphasized institutional authority and strengthened the power of the male priestly hierarchy. And yet there are some similarities. On the face of it, both these programs appear to assimilate modern secular values, as in Vatican II's emphasis on a more democratic way of thinking about what the church is, or at the very least, like correlation, implementing corporate methods of organization. Indeed, leaders in both traditions appear to concede the point. Pope John XXIII spoke of aggiornamento, an Italian word referring to bringing in of the new or engaging with the times. Similarly, Boyd K. Packer observed that, quote, there was a certainty at the beginning of the correlation movement that we were moving into some major social changes. And yet advocates for both traditions sought to push back against the notion that these efforts were a capitulation to modernity. Many invoked instead the language of religious restorationism, the notion that in changing, the church was in fact only tightening its grip upon its original identity. But in both cases, this language rippled through the tradition in unexpected ways. Restorationism did not have a single definition, but rather enabled a variety of ways of engaging with thinking about the past in both traditions. Many Catholic leaders who participated in the creation of Vatican II or embraced it spoke of ressourcement, a French term which emphasized a return to the early church, to patristics, to the Bible, and saying that this would reinvigorate the church in a modern age. John XXIII, opening the council, called for, quote, faithful and perfect conformity to authentic doctrine. This doctrine, however, should be studied and taught through the methods of research and literary forms of modern thought. More, after the council was over, the language of ressourcement became a tool to enforce a particular interpretation of what that council meant. Soon after his election, as Pope Benedict XVI, the former Joseph Ratzinger delivered a speech arguing that Vatican II should be interpreted with, quote, a hermeneutic of reform that emphasized continuity rather than transformation. And this way of talking about the council is popular today among Catholics who are impatient with the notion that the council was a moment of modernization. The theologians Matthew Lamb and Matthew Levering, for instance, argue that the council was not, quote, a liberal or progressive accommodation to modernity that aimed to overcome Catholicism's traditional conservative resistance to it. But other Catholics have disagreed. For instance, some American Catholics read Vatican II in precisely the ways that many advocates of ressourcement feared, as a mandate to plunge into a secular narrative of history, that is to seek engagement with a pluralist society and reform predicated on scientific and professional methods. The sisters in the Congregation of the Immaculate Heart of Mary in Los Angeles, for instance, were educators. And 2 years after Vatican II concluded, Mary Humiliata Caspari, the Reverend Mother of the Order, announced reforms designed to reflect, quote, a new understanding of our contemporary world's need, and, quote, the growing importance that our society attaches to the services of professionally trained women. Sisters in that order then could now pursue training that reflected their aptitudes. They could adapt their clothing styles to fit the world around them. They could pursue vocations outside their order's traditional emphasis on education and healing. According to Caspari, they were, quote, simply following the spirit of the Vatican II Ecumenical Council. But while Catholics like Caspari viewed the council as a way to reconcile modernity with their traditional mandate, others found that idea horrifying and sought in it evidence that the council was illegitimate. The New York visionary Veronica Loikin, for instance, found in the tradition of Catholic mysticism the conviction that Vatican II had surrendered to a technocratic, bureaucratic, and male modernity, personified in the figure of Paul VI, the Pope who concluded the council. Instead, Lucan offered her spiritual authority as a way to defy Vatican II. In September 1969, she had a vision of St. Therese, who gave her a message to deliver to the Pope, imploring him that, quote, the word of God is eternal and cannot be altered or changed. Restore all changes to the original word of God. Have men follow these rules with the love of God and do not change the rules for love of man. The meaning of Vatican II, then, has been endlessly contested, and its restorationist appeal to an ancient Catholicism presumed to exist opened the doorway for a variety of readings of its intent, which reflected the different needs of Catholics in America. Now, in contrast, Mormonism from the beginning had linked notions of restoration to ecclesiastical authority. While Catholics worried about the relationship between the Pope and the bishops and the Roman and local leadership, leaders of the Mormon priesthood worried that the powerful auxiliaries of the church, which they perceived to be more focused on modern values, like expertise and efficiency, were stifling the traditional religious authority of the priesthood. The Apostle Harold B. Lee, who directed Correlation in 1965, insisted that his goal was, quote, to get the priesthood fully defined and work out the scope of its programs, to bring the priesthood back to where it should be according to the revelations. Excuse me. And then determine the relationship of the auxiliaries to the priesthood. In practice, this led to a centralization of authority in the male priestly hierarchy, which weakened the authority of female-led auxiliaries. Officials from the former were placed over the latter, whose previous financial and program independence was thus foreclosed. As the Apostle Bruce R. McConkie wrote, if attempts are made to transport the power of the gospel through auxiliary circuits or fringe committees appointed for specific purposes, the Lord's people are denied the blessings that a perfect organization, perfectly operated, would bring. Now, the disjuncture between the anxiety which drove Correlation and its product is kind of striking. On the face of it, indeed, Correlation seems eminently bureaucratic. Lee generated an army of new committees, he regularized lines of authority, he instituted standard reporting procedures, and so on and so forth. But, as Lee had, Mormon leaders read the Correlation program as a restorationist gesture. The Apostle Marion G. Romney claimed that these reforms meant that, quote, the church is moving in the way the Lord presented it to Joseph Smith before the church was organized. Repeatedly, advocates of Correlation linked these bureaucratic efforts to scriptural precedents. As the BYU religion professor Hiram Andrus wrote in one Correlation manual, do you know the reason why the city of Enoch was translated? It was because they had the Correlation program of the priesthood. Now, for some Mormons, this defiant anti-modernism was compelling, and for some women, it could serve as a source of authority against a largely male world of training and expertise. Barbara Smith, who served as the church's Relief Society president in the 1970s and 1980s, was one such woman. She argued that Correlation was successful precisely because it spurned those modes of authority. She observed in 1977 that her position in Lee's Correlation Committee put her at loggerheads with, quote, these men in the church who had their doctorates. I could see that sometimes their academic training led them to put material and information in ways that would not be helpful to members of the church. She thus found in Correlation the authority to override academic training. She also embraced complementarian gender roles and hence affirmed the authority of the male hierarchy, seeing this as reflective of the original intentions of Joseph Smith. But other Mormon women embraced a very different notion of restoration, which they believed contra correlation would weaken the power of the church's male priesthood. In 1992, the Mormon scholar Maxine Hanks published a thick edited collection titled Woman and Authority, Reemerging Mormon Feminism. Throughout, Hanks and her authors are inspired by, as she puts it, quote, larger feminist waves, as well as, quote, the 150th anniversary of the Relief Society, the women's organization of the LDS Church. Just as Correlation then clothed the modern impulse towards bureaucracy and rationalization in the language of restoration, so did Hanks clothe modern feminism in the language of Mormonism's past, writing that, quote, feminism has always existed in Mormonism. Scholars like Hanks, Linda King Newell, and other contributors argue that the Mormon past required a larger place for women in their church. For Newell, the lesson was clear. Quote, a broader, more inclusive understanding of priesthood could mean a re-examination of the LDS policy of ordaining women to priesthood offices, or it could simply mean making changes in the General Handbook of Instructions, which have stripped women of these opportunities. Both then the Constitution of the Second Vatican Council and Harold B. Lee invoked Paul's metaphor in Corinthians to describe their reflective institutions as the body of Christ. Lumen Gentium, one of the constitutions of Vatican II, insists that Paul, in describing the church as the body of Christ, teaches that the church and its people are a single mystical whole. When Lee, though, referenced that same scriptural metaphor, he drew a different lesson. As you think about these scriptures, he said, they were given to impress the need for constant and continued consultation and correlation of the various subdivisions of the church. Thus, Vatican II uses restorationism to distance Catholicism from bureaucracy. Lee seeks to baptize bureaucracy. Both the Mormon apostle and the bishops of the Catholic Church appealed to the religious past to define what their respective religious traditions should be. And yet neither could return to that past in an uncomplicated way. Indeed, neither really wanted to, because Restorationism is less a quest for historical purity than it is a strategy of legitimacy. Both programs sought to appeal to the past as a means to grapple with the modern values that they saw in a secular America, and in neither case, then, it was an unqualified success. In either case, other voices, variously pleased, distressed, or dissatisfied with the institutional language, seized upon their rhetorical strategy. And the uses to which they put the past illustrates the endless malleability of the language of restoration in institutional religious traditions. Thank you.
Last summer, I was privileged to be part of a Mormon theology seminar at Union Theological Seminary in New York City. And in fact, our fearless conveners are up here, the juvenile delinquents in the second row. We participants spent our days dissecting a chapter from the Book of Mormon and our evenings enjoying the city, which is not a bad way to live. I would highly recommend it. For one of those evenings, we walked around the corner to Richard and Claudia Bushman's apartment for dinner and conversation. Even though they had just arrived back in New York the day before, after spending time, I think, here in Provo, they took it in stride that, of course, they had the energy to shop for and feed and entertain 8 more people for dinner. After dinner, we retired to their living room and talked for a couple more hours. In particular, Richard wanted to go around the room and ask us a question that I hope I'm not embarrassing him by recounting here. He wanted to confer about best practices to communicate with his young adult grandchildren. How, he asked, could he show them how much he cared about what they were interested in, even when those interests might lead them away from the LDS Church? How could he let them know that his love for them extended far beyond whether or how they chose to be Mormon? Since some of our younger seminar participants were the same age or maybe a little bit older than Richard's grandchildren, he thought they could offer some insights into shared connection. I don't remember much about how we responded, but I was very struck by the question itself. Here was an elder statesman who sincerely wanted to know and learn from people 1 or 2 generations younger than himself, someone who was eager to put being in relationship above being right. He basked in the role of the student as much as he did in the role of the teacher. This is not an isolated incident. Back in 2007, when Richard was speaking at a forum sponsored by the Ethics and Public Policy Center, he apparently looked out at the room full of mostly young journalists and was as covetous of their insights as they were of his. I was struck, he said, by the immense cultural power that resides in all of these young people. In fact, I asked if during the second half of the Q&A I might take over the meeting for a while, instead of you asking impossible questions and me generating imaginary answers to them, I would begin to ask you some questions, because I would be very interested in knowing how you situate Mormonism and your estimate of what is happening on the religious scene generally. Richard Bushman is not just a scholar, but a deep listener. And as I think about the future of the LDS Church, and particularly about the relationship between scholarship, the academy, and the church, I must confess that I believe we should clone him. I want to see more Richard Bushmans. I want to see people who are as committed to listening and learning as they are to imparting knowledge. Richard's question that evening suggests 3 different ways in which I think his approach offers a way forward, a new kind of pedagogy for the LDS Church today. First, listening. Over the past year, I've been in the early stages of a research project about Mormon young adults. Among the questions I'm raising through a social science component and also qualitative interviews are issues such as, are we Mormons in fact losing more of our young adults than in the past? If so, why do they leave? Is it true they are upset about thorny questions in Mormon history or troubled by contemporary social issues like LGBT equality? Do they feel left out of decision making? Or do they feel burned out with too many church responsibilities? Are they simply bored? All of these have been suggested as possibilities. And so far in my research, without the quantitative data, which will be available later this summer, they all register in interviews as possible reasons. If the Pew numbers are to be believed, the overall Mormon retention rate declined from 70% in 2007 to 64% in 2014. And if we are to believe other earlier studies, the 70% figure from 2007 already represented a decline in retention from what it used to be in the 1980s. I would suspect, based on cohort patterns more generally, that when we are able to break down the 2007 and 2014 Pew numbers, we will find that millennials, or young adults ages 18 to 35, are leading the way among those who say they grew up LDS but no longer self-identify that way. And the first thing we as a church should be doing right now is not rescuing them, however noble that impulse. It's not fellowshipping them back into church activity. It's doing what Richard does, either naturally or because he has cultivated as a spiritual practice. We need to listen. Just listen. As a church, Mormons do so many things so well. One of those is coaching. We set clear objectives for ourselves and others, and we communicate those goals effectively. We have certain milestones set in place to let us know whether we are achieving those goals, if it's an Eagle Scout Court of Honor or a missions baptism rate. We train people to perform to their highest levels of effectiveness. Through lessons, talks, firesides, we convey our standards and instruct others in how those standards can be realized. We are terrific coaches. But we do not have institutional mechanisms in place to encourage people in our church to simply listen. That's particularly true when it comes to listening to young adults who have very little institutional voice in the church beyond what leadership roles they may serve in at the local level, particularly in singles wards. Also, never before have we seen such a large generational gap between the LDS membership in the United States and their top leaders who are collectively older than ever before. If two-way communication is going to begin, the leaders will need to initiate it, and some recent initiatives show that they are trying. The recent transparency, as Matt number one has referenced, in matters of LDS history demonstrates a willingness to grapple with more difficult questions. Commitments to including controversial issues in seminary instruction, in what Elder M. Russell Ballard recently called the Doctrinal Mastery Program, sound promising. What I have not yet seen are any formal or even informal programs to suggest the LDS Church is listening to the concerns of young adults. By this listening, I mean not just hearing, but also suspending judgment, refraining from giving advice, and learning to ask open-ended questions that don't already have acceptable right answers. Strong listening skills are predicated upon a real openness to questions, a lack of defensiveness, and a lack of fear about where the conversation may head next. All of these are qualities I have observed in Richard Bushman. Two. Truth-telling. As a historian, Richard has been one to gently but firmly lead the way for greater openness about the most controversial or complicated narratives from LDS history. He has been saying for decades now that we owe it to our young people to tell them the truest versions of those stories that we can access. We want the story we tell each other to be based on the best possible historical evidence, he has said. Any shrinking from that mandate will only lead to more problems down the road. I think the church is trying to create that kind of comprehensive, accurate narrative. In a few years, he said, there won't be any more surprises. I don't know about that last part. At times, it has been fashionable in the study of pedagogy to see the teacher as a truth-telling figure who smashes ignorance and releases intellectual captives from the bondage of mistaken ideas. And despite the arrogance of such a view, there's probably a part of every professor that secretly hopes that it is true. Without at least a shade of the superhero complex, it can be difficult to stay motivated in the classroom. But what I see in Richard's example is that he's not interested in playing the superhero. In one interview, he conceded that contradicting the standard narrative of church history is a delicate matter. People get disturbed, and the questioner feels rebuffed. I ran into this problem at Claremont, where the graduate students offended church members with their expert knowledge in the New Testament when it ran against the standard views. I think two things have to be kept in mind, he continued. If your secret wish is to be an iconoclast, to break the images, church members will sniff that out. Or if you want to parade superior knowledge, as some of the Claremont students did, you will meet resistance. If your wish is to help people understand our history better, you are more likely to be accepted. I see Richard's approach to teaching as very much in line with what Parker Palmer espouses in The Courage to Teach, namely fostering what Palmer calls a community of truth. The community of truth challenges the top-down flow of knowledge that has been the dominant model in most institutions, including the academy and the church. In the traditional model we have long employed, the subject matter becomes an object. And the one disseminating information, the unquestioned expert, everyone else is in a posture of learning about the object from a distance. In a community of truth, he says, Parker Palmer, quote, as in real life, there are no pristine objects of knowledge and no ultimate authorities. In the community of truth, as in real life, truth does not reside primarily in propositions. And education is more than delivering propositions about objects to passive auditors. Instead, in the community of truth, those we have formerly cast as students become knowers who are in relationship with the subject, giving it the respect and authority that we normally give, Parker Palmer says, only to human beings. I would not go so far as to say that truth-telling can only occur in Palmer's community model, but I would say that relationship with the subject matter is only possible in that environment. Richard's educational model, both in Mormon studies and when he was my professor at Columbia, incites passion in students because of community. I'm pretty sure that in my 5 years as a graduate student, Richard and Claudia were the only professors who routinely had students over for dinner. That seems such a simple thing, but it isn't. Seminar papers were read and debated outside of the classroom, in the home, with Richard and Claudia just as concerned about the kind of community their classes were fostering as they were about how we assimilated the subject matter. And finally, holism. For Richard, scholarship and church and community have never been neatly compartmentalized. There is a holism to his person that I deeply admire. Mormonism affects his scholarly output despite the fact that others in the academy might see a wide fissure between his LDS beliefs and his capabilities as a historian. He has said, I am asked to give papers and review books and have never felt that my religion prevents me from engaging in all the usual routines of modern academic life. But apparently the crazy Mormon side of my mind is envisioned as sequestered in some watertight compartment where it cannot infect my rational processes. Beliefs inhabit a realm of feeling and traditional loyalties where we are not called to rational account and where eccentricities and bizarre ideas can be tolerated. Probably, my colleagues have peculiar notions of their own, he says, that they would not want to defend before a panel of academic critics. There is a pragmatism, I think, to Richard's refusal to separate his faith from his scholarship. This is what the Greeks would have called phronesis, or practical wisdom. What do these truths mean in the living of your life? How do they augment your ability and inclination to bless the lives of others? Richard has been clear that in his teaching and his scholarship, he's not interested in the pursuit of knowledge purely for its own sake. Objectivity, he says, is the claim of people who think they are gods now, not of persons worshiping God and striving to be like him, or of persons who understand the reality of finite human life without God. Even when science has done its work to perfection, it fails to tell us how to live a life. I appreciate the wholeness in Richard's point of view, and I feel that it's something that many people have lost in the academy. Richard has famously, as Philip Barlow noted when introducing Richard's essay in the pioneering volume A Thoughtful Faith more than two decades ago, Richard has famously traded in the irony that as one of the church's finest intellectuals, he would argue, in the end, for the final irrelevance of the intellect in matters of faith. Richard does not see the intellect as unimportant, but as a catalyst to the deeper growth that is possible with faith and humility. I'd like to close with Richard's own thoughts on the intersection of faith and scholarship, as told to historian Quincy Newell in correspondence and reproduced in Richard's autobiographical work, On the Road with Joseph Smith. Mormons stick to the Book of Mormon, Richard says, because, quote, we find God in its pages, or inspiration, or comfort, or scope. That is what religion is about, in my opinion, and it is why I believe the Book of Mormon. I can't really evaluate all the scholarship all the time. While I am waiting for it to settle out, I have to go on living. I need some good to hold on to and to lift me up day by day. The Book of Mormon inspires me, and so I hold on. Reason is too frail to base a life on. I think it is far better to go where goodness lies. Thank you.
Let me begin by thanking Spencer and Kathleen and Jed for organizing this conference. It is an exciting operation and also incredibly gut-wrenching. Thank you for that. Also like to thank the Beasleys, the Neurons, and the Quinns for their support. You cannot imagine how important that is. And I cannot think of a more fitting tribute to Richard Bushman for this conference. These papers approach the issues of scholarship, teaching, and faith from different angles and perspectives. I will comment on the specifics of each paper, but then focus on a larger theme, the practice of history and the goals of scholarly research. What can we expect of historical analysis? What are the tests of historical interpretation? Can historians quest after religious truth? In preview to my conclusions, I want to frame my comments with the standard motion picture tagline. This film is based on a true story. Also, please indulge my desire to revise the order of the papers to make my points more smoothly and coherently. So let me begin with Matt Bowman's paper. Matt assesses in his comparative piece the Catholic Church's Second Vatican Council and the LDS Church's Correlation Committee as responses to a secular and pluralistic world. In fostering messages of restoration and renewed ideological purity, the two initiatives sought to legitimize church authority and firm members' commitments. Here the emphasis was on continuity, reclaiming a seemingly virtuous past or one that had not yet been fully rationalized, rather than changing to accommodate the times. Note here that Matt alerts us to the matter of immediate, subsequent, and discordant conversations about the meaning of events. He writes of the variety of stories about Vatican II and how it was, quote, unquote, endlessly contested. Some interpretations were ideological, while others were rooted in gender analysis. Similarly, correlation was framed as pro and anti-feminist. Authorities were both supported and denied in their efforts. I like this piece for several reasons. It is a complex story well told. Rather than looking inward and being mired in parochialism, Matt finds distance from his own tribe to draw insights from the experiences of those of a different faith tradition. It is imaginative and analytical and not simply descriptive. Nor does Matt seek consensus or order. Instead, he is comfortable with divergent voices and cacophony. These are the marks of a well-trained historian. Historians are not taught to search the past to make or uphold truth claims. They sift through history's artifacts, newspapers, diaries, documents, and correspondence to discover what men and women did and believed. The historian knows past events only through the eyes, ears, and minds of history's participants. Historians are well aware that these sources carry the creator's opinions and are filtered through specific race, class, gender, religious, and ethnic identities. Nor does the coloring of historical data end there. The past records of ideas and arguments are then sifted through the historian's own identities and screens to be fashioned into interpretations. Peers, in turn, measure these by tests of evidence and logic. The merging of the observed and the observer references the uncertainty principle proposed by the German physicist Werner Heisenberg. The idea here is this: the very process of observing, of making measurements, alters the thing or event being observed. Objectivity is muddy and an unattainable outcome. Truth is elusive and unknowable. It is dependent upon time, place, and community. Those who proclaim it become partisans and reap little reward outside their tribes. In his comparative piece, Matt Groh takes us to the Church History Department to consider change over time from the Leonard Arrington spring to history making in the present. His insights are valuable and put the story in clearer perspective. Matt notes the dynamics of the different periods, relating to shifts within and beyond the church regarding transparency, institutional structure, and professionalism, and internationalization. At the same time, Matt is struck by continuity in mission and agenda. The goal remains a complete and honest telling of Mormon history. Similarly, there is a shared focus on narrative history, women's history, and history from the bottom up. What Arrington identified as the toughest problem continues: the tension of balancing on two legs, the leg of faith and the leg of reason. This is the great challenge. Can the Church History Department be credible with professional scholars, yet publish works that build testimonies, spread the word, and build the kingdom? The Church History Department is producing documentary publications that are vital for two reasons. They provide the raw materials for research, and they counter conspiracy theories and suspicion of official cover-up. Interpretation, however, is not their focus. More problematic, then, are narrative histories. My grand inquisitors are historians, not university administrators. If LDS authorities have extensive oversight, the peer review process can be difficult to navigate. Are tests of historicity to be applied to Mormon sacred documents, sacred stories? Are the gauges of honesty and faithfulness compatible? Will interpretations that are not faith-promoting or perhaps faith-demoting pass muster? A section of Matt's paper caused me to stumble. Matt quoted Leonard Arrington to the effect that the Church History Department needed to inoculate members by exposing them to more uncomfortable aspects of Mormon history. The implication of this medical metaphor is that doubt is a disease. Perhaps we need to reconceptualize this. Questioning and doubt are the first steps on the path to study and understanding. Doubt is not a step away from faith. It is a step away from indoctrination. Only when women and men feel that they have been blindsided or intentionally misled is faith questioned. Also visible in this paper is a strategy that can work to cut through some of these issues. It resembles history writing that comes out of a Jewish tradition. Except with children, Jews rarely talk about parting seas or walls come tumbling down. Nor are they defensive when discussing kings like Saul and David, who were not only complex but deeply flawed. Narrative Jewish histories are stories of achievement, of struggle, of persecutions, of disappointments. There is little attempt to hide from or sanitize the past. What these accounts reveal is a past that guides the present and future. They also secure identity and intensify commitment to community. They are not the matter of indoctrination or history by authority, but examples that illustrate how people can repair the world. With such history, Jews in full knowledge come to understand who they are and what is of deepest meaning. The Church History Department can lead the way in these matters. In fact, it already has. Rick Turley and Ron Walker's book, Massacre at Mountain Meadow, published by Oxford University Press, has received critical acclaim from professional historians as well as members of the Mormon community. It, like the coming sequel, deals with hard issues that were more dangerous hidden than exposed. Histories that consider Latter-day Saints politically, socially, internationally, and economically, and maintain professional standards, will open up a dialogue with those beyond the Mormon community. They can only add luster to the Church History Department. Such histories must avoid the pitfall of truth-telling, yet still inspire faith. Janet Riess's subject is Richard Bushman. I first encountered Professor Bushman when I was in graduate school and read his well-received book, From Puritan to Yankee, Character and Social Order in Connecticut. I have followed his publication career since, but have not known him as a teacher. Janet draws that portrait with passion, and her essay is a model for pedagogical excellence. Bushman is not simply a source of information and insight. His listening is not simply a passive act, but a method that suspends judgment and shows respect. It makes students feel less vulnerable and more willing to share their ideas. Bushman exemplifies a teaching philosophy that is not simply vertical, but has the most effect horizontally among peers in community. Jana also praises Bushman for his openness to the complicated narrative of Mormon history. She concludes by noting Bushman's holism, that his sense of faith and community and animates his scholarship. These words bring great joy to me, not only because I prize teaching. As a community and according to our tradition, Jews lavish great praise on teachers and scholars. In the Talmud, it is written, "The real guardians of the state are teachers." It also records Rabbi Hanina, who once remarked, "I have learned much from my teachers, more from my colleagues, and the most from my students." Jana has convinced me that Richard Bushman is a latter-day Rabbi Hanina. Janet Riess is privileged to have had a teacher like Richard Bushman. Richard, in turn, is fortunate to have a student who so eloquently captures the essence of his contribution. In responding to this piece, I will echo points made earlier in my presentation. Religion and history ask different questions and seek different answers. Religion is not rooted in facts and dates and historical interpretation. It is about relationship with God. Religion is faith in something beyond the record of mortal men and women. It teaches values, how to live a humane life, and how to give service to all. History is about interpretations that are subject to logic and evidence. These interpretations are not truths, but conditioned by circumstances, both personal and societal. We do not impose an obligation on the biologist or the chemist or the physicist to confirm faith, nor should we expect the historian to shoulder the burden of religious truth. That is a matter for the philosopher, the theologian, and the believer. Thank you.
Thank you to all of our panelists. Good luck, session two. Rich already, and now time for what we hope will be a lively Q&A. Because of the spatial organization of the room. If you've got a question, I'll call on you from the podium. I'll probably restate your question. We are filming the proceedings, and then I'll invite whoever has been addressed to come forward. I would like to give an opportunity to any of the three speakers, though, to respond to Professor Goldberg, if you'd like. Hesitations and no more. Your chances now. We'll open it up for questions, and if any of you would like to address anything, just let me know. Any questions for our panelists? In the back, please. Which Matt, Steve? Matt 2? The question for Matt relates to the different sizes and demographic situations of Roman Catholicism and Mormonism, and how does that work in terms of a comparative analysis like the one you've carried out? Different churches, different traditions, different demographic situations.
The phrase controlling for that didn't occur to me. That sounds too scientific, and I did not do very well at math in high school. But it is a legitimate statement, certainly. I specified that I was looking at Catholic responses in the United States, particularly, but I also think that the global nature of the Catholic Church, and the numbers are even, of course, more skewed in the 60s, the period that we were talking about, meant that modernity meant something somewhat different for Catholics in that period. Catholicism was confronting, I think, a kind of de facto plurality within its own institution, which Mormonism had only begun to deal with. However, it is true that in the middle 20th century, Mormons were beginning to feel those same pressures, the pressures of being a worldwide faith, the pressures of growing diversity, whether the top of the church wanted it or not. And so, certainly, I think issues like the Third Convention, right, in which Latin American members, in Mexico, I should say, Mexican saints sort of resisted the top-down hierarchy, as well as some of the events in Africa that were occurring there as well. So in that sense, I think they were dealing with similar situations. Now, their responses certainly were different. As I noted, Vatican II sought to decentralize power and to devolve power to local authorities, while Correlation's response was to centralize power. And that certainly, I think, was really a response to the facts that you point out, that for the Roman Catholic Church in the 1960s, centralization was, in some sense, a logistical improbability, while Mormons were still small enough, only 3 million Mormons in 1970, that they could, in fact, try to issue some more top-down control.
Next question, please. And I'll invite any panelist to address the questions about inoculation, this metaphor. How does it relate in the past, present, possibly future? What are the implications of such a metaphor with regard to history and education? Any of the panelists who want to address this, because certainly Professor Goldberg brought this to the fore as well. So Matt, Jana, or Matt, if you'd like.
Well, I wish the two people I quoted about inoculation, Leonard Arrington and Marlon Jensen, could respond to this. It's a really great question. I think Bob points to one of the real challenges of using that metaphor, right? Which is that it does treat doubt or questioning as if it's some sort of disease. And I think one of the messages that we need to embrace in the church is that questions are good, doubts are natural. They're part of the religious process. So I see you going a couple different ways with your question. One is, you say, well, the scriptures say we see through a glass darkly, and I see that as what I think part of what we need to understand better as we try to tell more complete narratives about the Mormon past, right? And that, I think, is what Arrington and Elder Jensen were getting at with this idea of inoculation, that we need to be honest about the complexities of the past, We need to be honest that some narratives are faith promoting and some are faith deflating, and they're all part of our past. We don't need to hide from our history, and certainly we haven't done that as well in the past as we could have as a people, as a church. And I think that is what I see by this analogy of inoculation, is the embracing of a more complex history, a more complex path, of more complex past, of being willing to share that past in very forthright kind of ways. And I think what you sort of what Jana pointed to, along with what I pointed to, these gospel topics essays, that's what I see them trying to do.
Yes, please. The question relates to meaning-making after these kind of history-making events, and the question of how malleable the meaning can actually be if there are, in fact, limits to both the rhetoric and the reality of the meaning-making project after these things.
Sure, and in one sense, that's a fair point, right? Nothing is endless, although I guess Latter-day Scripture would dissent from that. But I think the point that I'm making here is that restorationism is invoked in both traditions, first by the Second Vatican Council itself and also by the framers of correlation, as a strategy of authority, right? To say we are going to define what our past is. However, within each tradition, there are other groups who read that tool in very different ways and who mobilize that tool in very different ways. And so I think what I'm getting at with the word endless is that it's contestable, right? And it's contestable in ways in which everyone who's using the term dislikes. The leaders of Vatican II would like it to have a single definition, as you're pointing out, right? The leaders of Mormon correlation certainly would like to be the ones who define what correlation is all about and what it means to be restorationist within the Mormon tradition. But there are voices within the Mormon tradition who have an alternate reading of that. And so we could have, I think, as many reproductions of this argument as there are people who want to make them. So both traditions are essentially constantly contested. So endless, I think, less in range and number of interpretations, but endless in more perhaps a chronological sense. And this argument is not going to be resolved.
Mm-hmm. In the back, please. The question for Jana, as she's coming up, relates to listening as a potentially passive activity, at least in a traditional mindset. How does that relate to a more active mode of pedagogy?
I think that we are looking at a much more systemic issue within Mormonism. If you've ever noticed, for example, even in the language that we use to describe someone who has lapsed in observance, we say they go inactive. Isn't that strange? You know, that is such a decisive and agentive way of putting it. But that's how we think. You know, we don't retreat, we don't go on retreats, we advance. And so I do realize that what I'm proposing here about listening is a little bit un-Mormon, but that should give us pause, if it is as radical as it is, that we would simply listen to people who don't necessarily have power for the sake of hearing them. What was the second part of your question? Mm-hmm. For me, the question is of suspending judgment, that we as a church could, when we train teachers, for example, about ways to engage the classroom, we focus more on involvement and more on getting them to go deeper and to not simply regurgitate what is in the manual, but also that we allow for disagreement and don't feel that it needs to be resolved. In Mormonism, we have evolved to this position where we see any form of disagreement as contention. And that is a problem, that we have to have a more positive understanding of diverse points of view.
Terrell Givens in the back. Terrell's question relates to the historian, questions of truth claims, and particularly as they relate to history in the Mormon tradition.
I actually have three comments to make over three of the different questioners. And so let me do that, and then I'll get to Terrell's comment. The first, in regard to doubt that was raised, I want to emphasize that I am of a people that wrestles with angels and argues with God. And we engage in a socialization process for our children where we demand that they question. I've taught religious school at my synagogue for 20 years. I've taught the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grades. And in regard to issues, for example, of Israel and Palestine, I insist upon giving them not an authorized view, not the accepted or the standard view, but a spectrum of views which represent the different combatants in those issues. And I do that because I want them to create and prepare their own understanding and explanations, because eventually they're going to reach people and interact with people who are going to disagree with them. And so I don't want them to go into these discussions with a catechism of answers, because that way lies danger. Historians have to come out from under the burden of religious truth. You know, when I think of Jesus and the crucifixion, and I think of the Gospels written 70 plus years after the events, I'm not even sure we're talking about history. History should not have to deal with those facts. And I understand the historicity of LDS doctrine and beliefs. But again, if you will, in my opinion, that is a dangerous dead end. The LDS people that I know are incredibly faithful people who have strong commitment to hard, intense, important values, a great commitment to community. And in my mind, their faith should not be dependent on events in the 18th and 19th centuries. Rather, they should be dependent upon how they act and how they behave today.
Please, here, yes. The question relates to the diversity of discourse between an academic sphere and a kind of an ecclesiastical sphere, and what if the vocabularies don't match? What does then that look, what does listening and pedagogy look like then?
Could you give an example of that translation moment when it's just not working out?
Yeah, so I'm thinking more of like truth is a big one, or I know something, you know. So in more discussions with people in my parentage, well, I'm not sure if I know that. And then being so startled by me not saying that I don't know if I know some piece of history or something, that they just sort of sense that the conversation can't continue. How can I be Mormon if I don't know X, Y, Z? When I think at the heart of it, I'm using a different word for know than they are. We just have a different way of defining it. And so, but the conversation kind of hits a roadblock before it actually happens.
It's fascinating that you would bring this up. You know, we've been talking here, and I think church-wide, about the issue of inoculation, inoculating the young people of the truths that may be unsettling for them about history, but there's a little bit of reverse mentoring that needs to go on as well. I'm glad you had that conversation. You are inoculating your elders about how your generation feels, and that's hugely important. That's a very brave conversation that needs to occur. Just go into it understanding that you are not going to come out of it in full agreement, but the conversation itself is vital. Thanks.
Specific examples of how international church makes a difference for history, history telling, and so on, to all three. So whoever comes up first will speak first.
Well, I mean, I think there's probably a thousand different answers to this question. Some of the things that impact how we do our work at the Church History Department is, one, in thinking about how to capture the history. So if we go back to the moment that Matt is talking about in 1960, most of the records being produced by church members are American. Most of the records being produced by church members are in Utah, even at that point, right? And so now we're at a moment in time when most records that would be of interest to future historians being produced by members of the church are not American, they're not Utahan, right? And so how do you gather that material? How do you preserve it for future generations of historians? How do you capture the voices of those people before they're lost? I mean, I think that is really one of the core questions that internationalization brings. So the way that internationalization affects our work is in thinking about who is our audience when we write history. To what extent is our audience an academic audience? The audience that we write for in the Joseph Smith papers. So in the Joseph Smith papers, we'll produce 28 books, none of which will ever be translated into anything other than English, right? Who is our audience? That's part of our audience. To what extent is our audience church members? And if we mean church members, to what extent does that audience not mean those along the Wasatch Front, right? And to what extent does that mean Americans writing the story of the international church? And to what extent does it mean French or Italians or Ghanaians or Brazilians writing the stories of the international church? And that's something where we still have a long ways to go. If you look around the church history department, we're a pretty American bunch, right? And we're wrestling with these questions, and we've begun to hire a few people and make use of that ecclesiastical structure throughout the world, but we still have a long ways to go. Another of the core questions when we think about any of the things that we write is about translation. So we can write all we want, but if we don't plan pretty carefully up front in terms of resources, in terms of translation, and then how broadly does any one particular thing deserve to be translated? If we've made a film that we did a few years ago on the church in Brazil, it was the first thing we released in Portuguese. We translated in English, but then do we translate into Spanish? Well, probably. Do we translate into what we call the Internet 10 language at church headquarters, which gets us to about 90-something percent of the church population? Do we go a little bit beyond that? The Seminaries and Institute program, when they do new manuals, they translate into 32 languages, right? The scriptures are translated into over 100 languages. And so where does any particular piece of writing fall on that spectrum is a really important question that we have to wrestle with just in terms of resources. So I think the internationalization of the church was something that Leonard Arrington was beginning to grapple with, and I don't think we're there yet. I think we have a lot of figuring out still to do in terms of all of this. Yeah, sure. No. So think of the cost of translating 28 books of 650 pages each. Then add to that the difficulties of dealing with the idiomatic language that they speak in the 19th century add to that all the, so first of all, it's a difficult English to translate. Second of all, just the cost of translating that into any one language is astronomical. So we've made baby steps, right? And we said, well, one of the most interesting things from the Joe Smith papers is the multiple accounts of the first vision. So let's translate those into lots of languages, right? But in terms of translating the core of that Joe Smith papers project into different languages, we're just talking millions and millions and millions of dollars if you were to do that in a serious way. But if anyone has, we're happy to have the conversation.
To the question of internationalization, we held a conference at the University of Utah in October on Black, White, and Mormon. And at that conference, we had Elder Satati from the 70 speak. And Elder Satati is from Kenya and talked about the strides the LDS Church was making in Africa. And to the great disappointment of many of the African Americans who were part of that conference, seemed completely unaware of any issues of race and racism that had existed as a history in the LDS Church in the United States. And I think that kind of rift is apparent and I think is explosive at the same time. But because the church is making such great strides among Africans, that is going to be a focus as opposed to this other. So an impact of internationalization.
In regards to the topic of correlation, I think this is a relevant issue as well. You know, I spoke of multiple ways in which I emphasize Mormon women understood what this restorationist rhetoric, which correlation marshaled, had interpreted, and sometimes in ways which were counter to how the leaders of the church wanted to interpret this. But this is also true, I think, when you get outside the United States as well. This is the period in which correlation is implemented, in which the church is becoming international, in a really tangible sense for the first time. And there are things, Bob mentioned Elder Satati, but there are things which people in other countries find appealing or interesting about Mormonism, which are not those things necessarily which the church hierarchy wants to convey. I'm thinking particularly of a document that a 70 wrote going to Africa soon after African congregations were established, and the ways in which he described African spirituality. He used restorationist rhetoric and said, well, you know, in our church, we have always spoken of spiritual experience as being something quiet and peaceful and internal, and these Africans, however, are expressing spirituality in much more charismatic ways, and this is something we need to fix. Right, and that was the language he used, fix, right? So I think, you know, these same issues that I spoke of in correlation in the United States are also present internationally. That's something I think that the church may be becoming increasingly aware of, but it takes a long time.
Mm-hmm. Spencer said I could say one more thing. So another of the things that we really wrestle with is, with our team of historians, sometimes we're writing for these very academic audiences, and then sometimes we're expected to communicate broadly with members of the church. And when we do that, we're asked to write at a ninth grade level, because that is the average reading level of the church throughout the globe, right? And so that's one of the challenges that we have, is that most of us come from these academic backgrounds, right? And we're writing across very different sort of types of products, very different kind of reading levels and everything that entails.
Ann Taves, you had a question. Would you like to?
The question of official histories among the contested histories of these events.
Certainly. So I primarily focus in the paper on American interpretations, but I have looked at the Catholic history in which you speak of, and certainly I think, you can look at the various perietti who are involved in the council, who are involved in writing of that history, who invoke these notions of Russell's Mont, and also I think of Neotomism as well, to interpret it and to say, you know, that and certainly this is John the 23rd's vision and Paul's as well, that what the council is trying to do, and this is set out in that history, is to balance speaking of a modern adaptation with a renewal of tradition. And the notion, I think, that is presented in that history is this notion of renewal as a way to engage with modernity. So resisting this kind of interpretation of change, of adaptation, and rather the church becomes more of itself, more like it is today. Now, I don't know if there is a history of correlation, an official history in the offing.
Can you imagine writing an interesting history of a committee?
It's very interesting, I think.
I think it'd be a tough sell. But I think it is really, really important.
Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. But I think also, the notion of an official voice as a concept is valuable, certainly, but especially in churches that are increasingly large, in traditions that are increasingly large, it's not overwhelmingly valuable. It's not as valuable, I think, as how people are actually experiencing what it means to live in a correlated church or in a Reformed church on the ground. And, you know, I'm not sure how many Catholics, particularly American Catholics, read this official history as they sought to interpret it. And, in the United States, there's a real division, I think, between what the council may have understood itself to be doing and what Americans often called the spirit of Vatican II, right? Yeah. Sure. Right. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Right. I have.
That will sell.
Yeah. So, at the very beginning of the debate over the Constitution on the liturgy, I think it's Cardinal Ottavati says there, after, I forget who spoke before him, but he states, what is happening here? Are we dealing with a revolution, right? And you have then, and he's not happy with that. He does not want the Vatican II to be a revolution, but he ultimately is in the minority of the council. And it is this language, I think, that you see emerging in those debates between people like him on one side and say, Augustine Bea on the other, or Congar, or any of these others. Ressourcement is the language which they use, I think, to paper over that difference, to say we are going to engage with the modern world, but we're going to do it in a way in which we are presenting it as an appeal to the past. Right? That is change within continuity, which is a word that I think Benedict uses.
And with that, we conclude session one. And now a round of applause for all of our presenters in session one.